the player. If you watch like LGD and TI4 when they lost to Newbie, it was just picking Nature's Prophet for Siler. We're not going to give him almost anything else. If he doesn't pick Nature's Prophet, we don't win. If we pick Nature's Prophet, we win. But now LGD, RTK is like, has a lot more faith. Like, he's leaving his hero pick to last. He's letting all of his heroes get banned, and he picks Slark in a game that's really kind of not that great of a Slark game, honestly. And he still does really, really well. I think Siler has grown up a lot. He's a extremely talented veteran player who's been around. I mean, he's got three top three finishes at TI. Like, no one else has been as consistently finishing as well as he has in TIs. And he's really, like, continuing to grow as a player, which I think is exceptional.
Yeah,
and they've left in the bat.
They left Alliances, everything in bat and Earth Spirit for LGD as well. So let's see what Alliance goes for. What would do you make of the Abaddon ban out from
Have
LGD?
Have we even seen an Abaddon pick in this tournament yet?
I mean, well, not in the mainstream.
Let me look.
I don't think we've seen one. I know it is a hero that Alliance like to pick, and it's maybe something that LGD are like, we're not prepared to actually deal with that hero. I think that LGD lost against EHOME once or twice recently when they drafted the Abaddon. Alliance, they're just gonna go for Bulldog Syllabeer though. I mean, that's a pretty safe start if it's allowed through. So they're not actually putting top priority on the bat either themselves.
We haven't seen Anabaton drafted at all. I want to see how often it's been banned though.
I don't think LGD will go for the Bat Rider, so in this case it would be okay to just leave it for the second pick if you want to. But it is a risk of getting banned out in the second ban phase, I would imagine.
It's such respect that you ban Abaddon when like no one's picking it yet. You're just like, this team might play it. We don't want to play against their Abaddon and. Yeah, of course,
surprise!
We know what Lumi's thinking. Two top heroes in the meta, apparently, Earth Spirits and Death Prophets.
LG, like, if you're Alliance, right? This is your dude or die match. There's no doubt about it. They have to kind of win this match in order to have a shot at making it through. So you're preparing for this match. You know what LGD will do. You are expecting Earth Spirit and Death Prophet in the first two.
Well, Alliance could still be going for the. Okay, actually, no, I don't even go down that road. I mean, they could lose this game and beat EG and go for the tiebreak, but they're obviously not going for the tiebreak, right?
No, they are going for the win. So you're expecting the Earth Spirit to be picked up first if you're letting it through. So they have a plan against it. That's what they leave us to believe. There's no other way. That's also what they leave LGD to believe, of course, who might then be maybe slightly worried, like, hey, do they have something special in mind? So far, we have a Londrude, we have a Chen.
Uh-huh.
Also, I think LGD was expecting that, because if you're going to be playing up against Alliance and you're leaving a Londrude in the pool, well, you're better going to be prepared to deal with that.
You know what the thing is? I actually think both of these teams come into this match feeling quite confident, and it makes sense for LGD. For Alliance, the thing I was talking about all the time yesterday is confidence, and I think they're a team that thrive on confidence. And if you look at their games yesterday, there's the one game that they won, there's the game they lost where they just got destroyed in the mid lane, the Chen rotating onto the Death Prophet all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the game which was like that, you know, crazy kind of Team Spirit out of nowhere just beat them.
Right.
So I don't think Alliance will feel like anyone has like taken them on in a fair game of Dota and beaten them, quote unquote fair. And I think that they'll expect LGD to do that. The game's going to be much more, I don't think it's going to be decided by some like small
LGD's
thing in one particular lane or situation. And so I think Alliance approached this game just like, we're playing Alliance Dota, that's it.
How active do you feel like this match is going to be in terms of aggression?
Usually MMY Earth Spirit does things early on.
Yes. It'll be a lot of aggression early, and then it'll kind of be a calm mid-game maybe, and then we'll have some fun late-game skirmishes, hopefully.
Do they look confident to you? Does Lota look confident? Is that a confident face?
Seeing him this morning, he looked a little... I don't know. It's hard to say. I feel like there's a little bit of frustration, a little bit of... There's been a lot of emotions for Alliance over the last couple of days, right? Like, they expected to do better yesterday. They were worried about not even being able to get into the tournament. But I think they're a strong team that can kind of rise above that. So I don't read too strongly into if they're tired or if they feel like they're overly emotional. I think they can still persevere.
By the way, my favorite individual Dota play of all time comes from a match between these two teams from TI3.
Okay.
LGD were bringing it back. They were going to be possibly the first team to take a game of Alliance in that tournament. They went into the rush, but Siler was Alchemist. That was like old Alchemist, really strong. They're rushing. And Ake's Quetzal used Blinding Light, knocked Siler onto the high ground, and like rush fight over, rush dead, game over. And I just felt like that kind of play, it to me, it exemplifies Alliance in terms of like both their creativity and their confidence. Remaining. Going into any situation, just we're going to do our own thing. They try for a really long time. Alliance kind of stubbornly kept doing their own thing, and people were like, "Why don't you adjust? Why don't you adjust?" And now they've come back to be like a tier one team again. Time. And I really think it is about confidence. And I really think that's why I'm asking you: do they look confident? You're saying, "Well, not sure."
They don't look confident, Alliance, but I don't read that much into it. Whereas you disagree, which I think is fine.
Yeah, disagreement's good.
Keeps things interesting.
It spurs discussion. It's okay. Unless you say, well, let's disagree and let's not just talk about
so
it.
So it's...
You're actually stupid.
Well, you're... You are wrong.
Wow, okay, so...
You're American.
You're right, you're
okay,
right.
Okay, so Bat Rider is banned.
We are bad at Dota, that's right.
I'm bad at calling names, apparently, as well. Batrider banned by LGD. I don't think it's a surprise. We still have a lot of S4 heroes in the pool. What do you feel like the chances are for him going for Puck again?
It seems to be a pick that they like against the Chin, but...
They were not against...
Oh, they're with the Chin, sorry, excuse me. So I don't think the Puck is the play for them this game.
Which hero can do well against Death Prophet, mate?
Lundred, which they do have, so they'd have to switch the lanes, though.
They actually did that before, they can do that, and we have seen
Lundred's really about it.
Yeah, Lundred is probably the safest bet against the DP, and it would actually explain why they prioritize it as first pick, leaving the DP in, so... That would still mean, though, there's an adjustment to their lane, so one of Lodo or S4 would have to start toward the off lane, and I think then it's usually actually Lodo who does that, they switch around the lanes that way. I'm not too sure. By the way, have we seen Sylar Gyro in this tournament yet? I mean, not that we need to. Gyro's like, everyone's comfortable on Gyro, but...
We'll see him today. Yeah. Right now.
And the Oracle. Turn to pick. Oracle Death Prophet, so strong. Oh, one thing. I am not completely sure how this works mechanically. And
Didn't
I was able to
yesterday?
Find an answer. I don't know if I got a firm answer about whether or not Spirit Siphon is considered healing to get doubled by Fortune's the ult.
I would not know.
Well, I don't know if False Promise actually buffs the amount of healing, because you were draining max HP, but when you gain the max HP, you actually gain HP as well.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that's considered healing for
but
False
even
Promise.
If it isn't, it's still a great combo, right?
It's still a great combo, yeah. But it's because you can keep the Death Prophet alive and Purifying Flames and keep her alive, so it's still good.
And she doesn't need to attack, so you just give her the 100% magic resistance. Doesn't matter that she's
right.
Disarmed. Get the loaded Juggernaut at the next pick. So they're leaving S4's pick for last. Turn to and maybe part of that is that they're not sure that they want to run the Lundred mid. Maybe they still want to consider putting something for S4 in the mid lane, and Lundred could still go to the off lane, which is his natural habitat.
Right. I like the Juggernaut here, I think. Remaining.
I mean, it's a pretty classic combo, Juggernaut and Lundred. This was like standard bread and butter pushing, healing ward plus Spirit Bear. What do they do? Got the Chen creeps as well. They got the Rubick for the aura. Reserve so time. Actually, this is going to be yet another team, I think, trying to assemble and push against LGD. Alliance maybe a bit more subtle about it because with the Jagger and with the Lundred, they've got quite a lot of scaling too. But I think plan A for Alliance is actually to push. And what a response to that plan A of pushing, Elder Titan. I'm sure that's the first time we've seen that in maybe.
I think this
patch.
I think this might be the first time we see ET this patch.
Yeah.
Okay.
I
explain
really like
to me
it.
The Elder Titan pick.
It's like it's a very big counter push kind of team fighty hero, but also just you put spirits on people and then they lose all their resistances, they become a lot weaker, and that makes it very difficult to go high ground.
10 seconds. This is the first Elder Titan this patch.
It's also particularly good against things that tank off their natural stats.
Mm-hmm.
And so Juggernaut, for example, is gonna go high agi, stuff like that. Okay. It's gonna contact the Rubick, extra spell resistance. And we finally see an S4 quap, so no stops in this game.
No, this is actually the third Elder Titan this patch. He just hasn't won yet.
Yeah.
Hasn't even gotten a kill.
This is the first game. I mean, we also talked about LGD perhaps, considering they're confirmed to be first in their group. We talked about LGD maybe trying out some new things to see how they do. And perhaps Elder Titan is part of that new strategy. It's not entirely new. Obviously, their whole draft doesn't look that new apart from the Elder Titan, but perhaps that's the one hero they want to see how it will fit in their play, but the draft is done. Alliance versus LGD. Is Alliance gonna have a chance, Brian?
I definitely think they have a chance. I like their draft a lot, actually. It's just, can they come back from the struggles they've had? LGD looks extremely strong. They've been executing better than every team they fought so far. I really like their support duo. LGD is one of the few teams I've seen play Oracle super well.
Yeah.
I think Oracle's been pretty hit or miss so far this patch, just because a lot of teams, I think, aren't quite sure how to use him. But Oracle Death Prophet is very strong, and if anyone can make it work, it's LGD.
I think Alliance look really comfortable. They got all the heroes they want. I think they're confident, I'm not sure. But if they are, I actually think they're gonna win.
One thing to look out for, Skent? What do we look out for to see if Alliance does well?
Part of the S4 co-op, I mean, S4 is the hero who decides stuff early on, and it's a hero that he was very good at when he was playing in secret, at least. He didn't play that much in the old alliance, but that we were mentioning yesterday how well is this co-op going to fit into this alliance when you've got the Lone Druid and Jaggernaut also farming.
Yeah. Okay. I think if we look like 15, 20 minutes into the game, if the Lone Druid is towards the top of the net worth, it's going to be really good for alliance. If he is 4th, 5th, kind of struggling a little bit, if they've been able to actually pressure the Lone Druid, then they're in for some trouble.
Okay, well, we're going to find out how much trouble either of the teams actually is, because it is time for LGD taking an alliance with OD Pixel and Gauss.
Thank you very much. We have got the game right around the final pick here from LGD. We've been treated here to a bit of an interesting one. Obviously, Alliance, they do get their strong heroes. They get that Bulldog Lone Druid as the first pick, but there's some really scary heroes going to LGD. They got that opening combo, the Death Prophet, the Earth Spirit. I don't know, man. This is going to be a real test for Alliance. They already mentioned it. This is an important game for them as well.
He's got Iron Talent too. Well, he knows how to play the offlane these days. The battle so begins. Iron Talent, Elder Titan, he wants to be able to kind of roam into the jungle as well with this. Make sure he's going to get zoned out by a Rubick jungling, so he's saying, I can jungle with this. Is he actually level 1 jungling? Are they putting like Earth Spirit in the offlane?
This is something completely new out of LGD, and
when you're using completely new in a game that doesn't matter to you, it suggests that they don't think it's actually a legit pocket strategy. It's just something they want to kind of try and experiment with. Like, level 1 jungling Elder Titan is probably not a legit LGD strat if they're going to do it in this match.
I'll see where he goes. I mean, at the moment, he's sticking there.
Yep.
It seems to be the plan.
It's a legit, like, hero, I think, this game. It's really good against, like, the Alliance push. Just having, like, the Spirit plus the Stomp is a great setup, and it can be a strong hero, I think. But, yeah, the way he's playing it is a bit gimmicky, I guess. But maybe a gimmick that could work out.
I guess it's kind of nice avoiding the safe lane of Alliance. You know, the old Jug Rubick combo is very strong, especially with, Ake Chen hanging around in the jungle. Whatever kind of offlaner you're going to send down there, they're going to be open to the vulnerability of being taken down mid lane. How else? Oh! It's a PogChamp. One in time. And I'm more looking for the roll in and the opening 2 combo that we saw in the draft. And some of the S4 is going to have to be very respectful of. And S4 Quap, I mean, we saw a bit of Dendi Queen come up in the land so far. And still being shown to its strengths. I mean, why do you feel S4 went for the Queen of Pain this game?
I think it's a hero that can get active. Like, you hit level 6, level 7, and then you can TP the lanes and create kills for your team. That's something he wants to be able to do. I don't think Puck was that good this game. It's normally used in, like, against certain heroes like the Chen the panel mentioned. And the other hero I think he'd prefer to the Quap, which was banned, is the Batrider. So he wants to be able to kind of play that Batrider-esque role. He's probably not going to get as much farm prioritization as some of the Queen of Pains you see mid get. And just look to use that ultimate whenever it's up, as soon as he hits kind of level 6, level 7 in lanes.
Yeah, and maybe it's one of the heroes that people feel has a bit of a strength against DP in the lane, because I think, in fact, Na'Vi, when they picked it up, it was also against the Death Prophet. And maybe something about the matchup that the players of the Quap like to favor for themselves. So far, I mean, whether the game's going to pan out, Jug, Loader's going to get free farm, of course, on this bottom lane.
Yep.
In terms of people rotating down here to try and make a go, I mean, when did the side of LGD actually send anyone down there?
Never. They send the Titan down there when they go for the push. So they're going to send heroes down there when they start pressuring the tower, but they won't be looking for kills. They'll just be looking to leech XP and keep the tower alive a bit longer. So, I mean, RTK currently has jungled his way to about level 3, as you do with the good old Iron Talon. So,
I can't wait for people to start doing this in pubs. This is.
Don't worry, I'm already there. Like, I just hit the random button by Iron
Talon. Oh, yeah. Right, yeah. Absolutely.
A random Abane. Oh, Iron Talon, sure, that works. You even buy Courier. Like, the team can't get mad. I bought a Courier, so I'll go jungle now. Like, it's great. We've ruined a few pub games.
There we go. I'll see if RTK ruins a competitive one. That's the thing. But as you said, even though they're already in a very comfortable position, LGD, the rest of their draft is. That's not a messing around, Jar. You don't pick DP, Earth Spirit, Jar, Oracle if you want to have fun. You pick them if you want to make the enemy cry.
Yep.
Yeah. LGD are showing no mercy straight up from the draft. Otherwise, now we've got that level 2. He's hanging around here towards the mid lane. Just seeing if S4 run a bit too much, but again, the Spirit Siphon comes out. It's going to force him to blink back.
That's kind of the big question for Alliance is also when do they go? I think more rather than when LGD center his bomb, it's when Alliance try to apply pressure. Because as soon as you start pushing out that bottom tier 1 tower, they know heroes are going to rock up and just take that XP and farm. So I think the better response is to do what they're doing now, which is play super greedy, We have stacks here, which Aki's farming just with EGM leeching experience. I think this is the right retaliation to like a very greedy jungling opponent that we're seeing in the Elder Titan. So for Alliances, even though Aki has a smoke, may look for like an early kill on the Death Prophet. I don't see him trying to get super aggressive and push the bottom tower early, even though they've got the empty lane. Both teams with stacks. I mean, this is going to turn into like a first 10-15 minutes of the game, it's going to be a farm fest. Yeah. Absolutely. And it's like, who can be greedier is currently the big question between these two teams. And then who's going to get away with like the levels of greediness that they show. Dire's
bottom tower is under bottom lane. TK has come in and oh, he's going to get caught out here by the telekinesis bringing him back. But quite have to lead in for the Alliance to go full in on this.
Yeah, Loda didn't go in for the spin, but I think he would have been fine because he had the bonus move speed from the spirit. So they zone him out though, so they will actually go for the early T1 tower. And the key thing is here, they're not allowing anyone to be in range to kind of get XP and farm off the tower.
Oh, S4 again mid lane, just getting off the blink. He's having to be very careful in this matchup, and he's playing it nicely. You know, 22-8 against the 18-6. He's slightly winning the lane against the Death Prophet. And that's with him pretty much purely being on his own. We haven't seen any of these supports of Alliance really go towards the mid lane. Rather on the side of LGD, you have had that Air Spirit constantly sitting there, kind of babysitting the Death Prophet.
I mean, we haven't actually seen much out of maybe as far as playing. I feel like even for LGD, picking Death Prophet is a little bit experimental in some ways for them, just because it's not a hero they've been playing a lot, but they realize it's a big hero this patch. So picking in a game that doesn't necessarily matter for them.
Yeah.
I mean, LGD are doing, they're going to be tryharding this game and trying doing everything they can to win. But I think from a draft point of view, it was a little bit like, okay, let's use this match as like an official, like a high, like kind of like a scrim in some ways, but even like more important. So.
Loda, he's got the Omni Slash to bounce. His will be there, and he'll get himself first blood as RTK. Just getting, well, it was under the tower, but it just felt a little bit out of position. He knew that the ult was up.
But punishing. So first kill goes his way. Bulldog and analysts talk about him having a good time in the early game, and depending on where he is as far as net worth goes, decides a lot of this game. He's currently looking for a first item Midas and only 16 CS for himself, so like Savage Roar just to secure a last hit, that's maybe not a good sign for the Lone Druid.
It's definitely not. We saw, I can't remember who they were playing against yesterday, but we saw a very incredible performance from Lone Druid, from Bulldog. But it's still early days.
And the greed is like favoring Alliance heavily right now. They've got four heroes with huge CS, 3,000 net worth advantage.
6 minutes in. Yeah. We're just one kill. This is just the farm.
Yeah, Death Prophet's out farming, getting out farmed mid by a small margin. They've got a Chen being greedy in the jungle. Lone Druid getting farmed in the offlane. Four of the five Alliance heroes are in some ways getting decent. Two are getting decent farm, two are free farming their lane. And then you've got Rubick who's at least getting something. So LGD are getting out greeted right now, and there's not much they can do about it. You've got to jungle the Elder Titan. Your Earth Spirit, I guess, is meant to be the hero who's kind of preventing that from happening. But because Queen of Pain, I think the Queen of Pain was a good pick mid because it just can't easily be ganked until Earth Spirit has like level 3 and has a stun as well as a silence. But LGD, I mean, they've got stacks all over their jungle. It looks like they will. They're actually going to put Gyrocopter in the jungle now to start coming up this stack. And they're giving the safe lane to the Earth Spirit to get some levels, to get towards his level 6. So LGD for the kills this game, let's just say.
Trying to step up their efficiency so they can keep on par with Alliance's progression, so fine in the game. And as you said, Joe, with the chair and the fact that Aki's just got great levels because of the stacks that he has created. And the TPs to this tier 2 looks like maybe a Spectre Smoke. They've got the Omni Slash coming back available in 15 seconds. This is the time to try and catch someone out.
It's a well-timed rotation from Alliance, like Omni Slash, and if they can kill someone like Death Prophet, that really sets LGD back. Uda actually reveals himself. That was
maybe
not quite
the right way to go. Yeah.
And I think LGD should fully know that that Jug is not going to be alone when he pops out of that smoke.
Yeah. Like, hang on, there's a Jug here on his own. Good one.
That should have, I think, been like a kill or two. So slightly mis-executed there from Alliance. But they're still in the enemy jungle. They want to get down some like deep wards maybe, find out where some of these heroes are. And more than anything, they're actually going to start taking towers too. Some of these stacks here now as well. I think that was double stack for LGD at the big campers. EGM's come in. He's got level 5 in a second, so levels and farm, all these Alliance heroes are like really happy right now. Gyrocopter's first big rotation to a teamfight has got to come up big for LGD, I feel. He's level 8, so he's got all the levels he needs. The early game farm, he picks up a Morbid Mask, but I think despite going for the Helm of Dominate build, we're still going to have to see Syla get active early if LGD want to be able to kind of counterplay any Alliance aggression or any Alliance pushes.
And the pushes exactly are going to be very, very strong once Alliance get those core items online, once they're able to get the mech on the Chen. when they group up and go. LGD, in terms of stopping it, she said the gyro, when he turns up, he's going to have that big kind of cooldown to force back the Trom Alliance.
E says, hello top lane. Level 6, almost level 7 on RTK. I guess that's what Iron Talons do. This is a PSA to start buying more Iron Talons, I guess, for all the viewers out there. I was just going for a fast drum. It's not exactly, not a farming item, so he wants. That's why he went for that early smoke gank, because he's going to play. When they pick the lone druid for Bulldog, you often see Loda kind of give up his own farm to make sure that Bulldog has a good game. And right now, the early game has gone really well for Loda, so that's why he wanted to go for that smoke gank. He's probably going to look for another rotation once this bottom lane's pushed out, and rather see more farm go Bulldog's way than Loda's as the game progresses.
Bulldog with that Midas now will be able to start and catch him back up, but he's, you know, you compare him to RTK, RTK 2.7k, so just 600 between two, or technically offlaners, obviously RTK spending more time in the jungle.
RTK, a hero that can do a lot more with less farm, like, that's a hero that just wants the levels, so, I mean, for a lone druid, if you're just getting levels and not farm, you're in trouble.
Oh, Sylai is going to get caught out here by GMS4 jumping in, the Sonic Wave fly through onto two, Sylai looking for the straight TP out, he will escape. DDC, can they chase this man down? Loda looking to move in with the boosted movement speed from the phase, but not quite enough to close that gap, and they both get themselves out of there. Alliance, unfortunately for them, not able to burst in and even them down.
And that's, I mean, Sonic Wave goes on cooldown, the big thing there. The cooldown, and much shorter cooldown, and not as big a deal there. And Hand of God also down. So I think LGD, if they can, like, find a opening as soon as cooldown comes back up, or try and group up and take a fight, they'll be really strong when Alliance don't have those two big ultimates on their side.
Top lane Bulldog, he's been caught out here by the Earthspirit. RTK moving in as well. The Hadouken from the neutrals helping out. Now find the kill. Loda trying to find something in return. Moving in with the Blade Fury. Hasn't quite got enough mana there for the Omni Slash. They'll turn around, drop the split just to stop Loda from chasing. S4 has come in, but of course he doesn't have that Sonic Wave. MMY is just going to go for the straight TP out, realizing a rotation has come in. And LGD playing nicely around the side of the lights and getting themselves that first kill on the board.
Because Cryptorm, which is a fun spell to have, instantly clear out waves and deep push, although it's only level 3, it's still, like, combine that with the Fade Bolt, you just have great burst damage potential. Two supports actually pressuring the mid tier 1 tower, forcing an RTK rotation. Well, I don't think they'll be able to push into the level 8 Elder Titan.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Three heroes, four heroes now, in fact, here. Alliance, I'm certainly just going to keep it safe. Lone Druid, Bulldog's gone down to the bottom lane to look for some farm. Loda sticking up top. He has still got that Omni Slash, so Sylar, it's going to be alright. I wondered if Loda might go for the full YOLO in, but it's still just a level 1 Omni Slash. Dyer's and mid lane Alliance is going to look to finish off this tier 1. Should get it. Got some of LGD on the high ground, but it's not enough to jump Dyer's in. S4, more money in the bank here for this Quap as he gets the last touch. And still at this point, it definitely feels like the farm game favouring Alliance very much so.
Yeah, and they've rotated Lone Druid towards the bottom now. It hasn't increased since that, like, early 3,000 gold lead at 6 minutes in, so that means LGD have at least been able to keep up and kind of starting to find a rhythm themselves as far as farming patterns go and just farming up the stacks. They've got the Helm of the Dominator now, so they can stack their Ancients, and first big teamfight is kind of going to decide a lot as far as where this game's going, because right now neither, it's been just two kind of small little pickoffs here or there. We haven't seen any kind of big engagement. LGD rotating four heroes bottom. This could be either just a free tier 1 tower for LGD, or if Alliance want to make a stand, they've got to bring in 4 or 5 heroes, and then we see that first big team fight. So it's kind of, we're either going to see the game transition into, like, you push, we're going to push somewhere else, or the two teams are going to say, let's fight head on 5v5, and it's going to be interesting to see which of the two teams makes the call to fight, or if they both just decide to push and counter push.
Dire's top tower has fallen.
Loda getting the space there for the top tower. And you can see Orchid halfway done on Quap. And just bear in mind, 13 minutes in, I mean, only 2 kills in the game. It's very much both teams avoiding each other. And yep, as you said, maybe just waiting for the bigger kind of mid game clashes.
The decision is like, okay, we'll just trade towers for now. And I'm not sure there's a big item anytime soon for any of the LGD heroes, which is going to change that. Gyro's not anywhere near like a BKB type pickup. And even like BKB alone isn't going to suffice against Sonic Wave, Omni Slash, Lone Druid physical damage, Chain Creep. I don't think like BKB is the item time for Silent this
game. He's getting wrapped around the pond. They've got the Sonic Wave, they're bursting down. Alliance catching him out.
Loader.
He's going to go for the straight up Omni Slash. He's still just a level 1-1 though. Now he's going to get Silent stunned up as well. And Loader, he's got the Blade Fury to move this one off. Will get himself out, but the roll forward, not going to quite close the gap. And Akane and S4 are there to split, catching a couple of them. But EGM, Telekinesis onto maybe, holding him back. Fade Bolt flies through as well. Now LGD has to be careful on the retreat. Maybe gets caught out there by Akane, the control there with the troll trap.
Alliance, they find a pickoff and followed up with a few more. And this is not even just kills going their way. This is space for Bulldog to farm, to push. He's up top hitting a tier 2 tower. Decent damage that, and also the mid lane T2 tower to stolen exorcism from EGM, adding some extra push here. Well, now the game gets blown heavily in Alliance's favor after those couple of kills. And that was just like Alliance, they're so much stronger. Jarvan's not ready to fight or able to fight into like all these big like AoE nuke damage spells that just bring him down incredibly fast. And I think LG as a whole just a lot of items they need before they can fight. And ET, like, he's got levels, but he doesn't add enough LGD's team fight to really give them the ability to fight right now. They're going Veil on Earth Sprint, and I think it's just because it's like, we need more damage if we want to be able to fight into Alliance. The Chen having mech and Hand of God is just too much for us, so. We're in trouble right now.
Yeah, they've got to certainly be aware of the fact that just farm-wise, map control-wise, everything at the moment favoring the side of Alliance. As you said, LGD, so need to come up with a big plan. I mean, in terms of kind of sitting back and continuing to play passively, do you think that can work out for LGD? Can they? Or is they just with their heroes, they just can't physically farm as fast as Alliance can?
It's good to try and find like pickoffs. They don't want to try and go for a big head-on team fight necessarily, but if they can, like, often Bulldogs alone, he's like an ideal pickoff for them, even though he's not the most farmed Alliance hero. But he's, I think, an important hero for them who will continue to look to farm by himself a lot of the time. So if they can find like a pickoff and then transition to towers and just avoid the group up of Alliance. They don't want to fight into their AoE spells just get so heavily negated by Chen, Mech, and Hand of God. Like any Radiant's big head-on engagement is not going to go well for them. It just negates too much damage coming out from Gyrocopter, Cooldown, Flak, Swarm, Elder Titan. You want to be able to focus down one and then not worry about the rest of the Alliance heroes.
Alliance are going to smoke up and heading towards the Rosh pit. Looks like it's going to be a smoke and go Rosh here. Cool from the side. Oh, Orchid now done.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Now they may feel that someone's around the Ancients. They're going to see the Ancients being done here. This could be a big time to jump. They can catch Tyler out here. He's got the backup of DDC. Loader moving in, and Sylar, he's going to walk straight into the telekinesis there, but the False Promise coming out. Sylar will be rooted though. A lot of damage getting laid down on him. It looks like this False Promise is just going to pop him as it's open. It does. They get the kill on DDC as well. Cooldown will slow down the side of Alliance, but now they're moving in for more. The root onto MMY. MMY taken down here by the side of Alliance. 3 dead on the LGD. Quickly through. It just catches the creeps at the jump forward from S4. Sonic Wave onto 2. S4's going to be careful about the Spirit Siphon. He will end up going down, but he gets the Orchid out to maybe. He'll use it off it, but he's surrounded by Alliance. Maybe to fall as well. Killing spree for Loader. 4 drop on LGD. Only RTK surviving.
And until Quap blinked aggressively, everyone, like Alliance had 3 kills and everyone was still full HP. And then Quap like kind of blinked in and died, unfortunately. But that was not even close to going LGD's way. Too much heal and sustain. The healing ward as well, another source of healing for Alliance. And LGD just don't have the damage to take a fight like that.
And as we saw that, EGM again with another big steal. He's got False Promise ready.
Oh, wow. He threw the Exorcism too. He was using Exorcism in the middle of the fight, then stole the False Promise. Like that was... Dream fight for a Rubik. He's had a big game, like as far as individual play goes, but more than anything, the Alliance just drafted the strategy is just looking so much better right now.
Yeah, I mean, this is, as we said, obviously, this game is of much importance for Alliance. They want to try and continue to the knockouts, and as we can see, they're taking this very seriously at the moment. It's kind of, this is Alliance, really. They're very unpredictable, you know. If you said, from what you've seen so far, who are Alliance going to beat in the groups, you probably wouldn't have said LGD, because they've destroyed some of the biggest teams in the tournament so far, LGD, and now, at the moment, Alliance are just walking all over them 17 minutes in, but there's still obviously the potential for LGD to turn it around. We've seen in other games where I think, like, EG versus LGD, EG very much had the kind of the lead, but LGD, they're very good at kind of, you can tell that they've got really good team synergy. They can compose themselves, keep their cool, and then slowly but surely grind themselves back on top. The Alliance at the moment, they've got to be feeling pretty happy with how the first 18 minutes have gone.
Yep. And LGD have the kind of draft that can buy time, defend high ground when you're looking at Elder Titan, Earth Spirit. What these two heroes can do as far as just these long range initiations and stuns, pushing into that is just so painful. And there's a veil as well, which amplifies the damage dealt. So I think Alliance, despite having like all these heals and stuff, you can just instantly clear that creep wave. So it's still going to be very challenging to push into LGD. And it's also stuns and disables, so it could just set up a cooldown, allow Death Prophet to go running in. So I think Alliance is still going to look to kind of... It's probably going to be the Chen Aghanim Scepter, which is like the timing where they can threaten high ground. And that's going to be really difficult for LGD to defend, because then you've got these magic immune ancients on the front lines that you haven't got physical damage to really bring down. And that's where I can see LGD... That's like the make or break moment. Can LGD defend against the Chen Aghanim Scepter?
Absolutely. That's going to be the next big step up. LGD now, they can look for a smoke. See what they have with this. Roshan is still up, but Alliance yet to be the ones to go back and look for it. Maybe level 11 wanting to use this exorcism for a bit of action and straight towards mid. Ake and EGM, the two supports could get caught out on their own here. The stun will miss, the fortune's then catching Ake. There's the stomp to follow through. The heal actually working for his favor, healing him up, but it looks like they'll still have the burst to bring him down as they roll him to the Ursprit. S4 trying to get in position for the fight. Sonic Wave comes through, catches four there. Massive Sonic Wave from S4. Loader now with Blavio chasing down ROTK. The cooldown is there to slow down the Joker right pitch from the tower. Will it bring him down? ROTK is still alive, but he does tick down to the Shadow Strike. S4 getting himself a triple and an ultra kill as he gets himself a fourth. And now he's looking for the Rampage. I don't know if he's going to be able to get it now. Sylar with the TP out just in time does get himself away. But S4 getting an ultra kill and absolutely deserved from the start of that fight, hitting that four-man Sonic Wave.
Yeah, and straight to like the Roche Pit slash Dire Ancients. That's the thing. Last time they...
Radiant stun. 20 minutes in as well.
This is the second time this game they've got to this Ancient stack and been able to steal it. The Battle Fear and the Jug making it even easier this time. Last time they got there and only kind of got like the leftovers, but it was like the big Ancient leftovers. So a lot of the Gyrocopter's catch-up farm this game has been denied from him, and that's something Alliance had been on point testing. A lot of teams there, they win that fight, they're like, okay, let's go get Roche now. Alliance is like, no, let's just steal their Ancients. We can always get Roche later. There's no way LGD have the lineup to take Roche. They could come in Nexus and for it, but Alliance, for the most part, have been on point scouting it out and preventing that from happening.
It's going from strength to strength here for the side of Alliance, for sure. And, well, Roshan's still there for the taking. It's something that Alliance could certainly look to go for. EGM, did he steal anything big at the end of that fight? What's
he got a Spirit Siphon, I think. At least at the start of the fight, he had Spirit Siphon. Rubik. We didn't see anything like an Exorcism or anything like that.
No, he didn't get the Exorcism again, did he?
No. Oh, he got Rock. And then he got Rock Barrage after
when when Jar was taking
out. So he got Spirit. I think he got Spirit Siphon, then he got the Rock Barrage at the end. Not really a spell you want on Rubik. 15,000 net worth lead. Whew, oh boy. It's starting to get more and more insurmountable for LGD. That's going to come down to the classic LGD high ground. I've seen them actually come back from these kind of games.
That's the thing.
Yeah, LGD of all teams is like, okay, even though this match doesn't matter for us, we're going to still make Alliance earn this win. Radiant's top
tower is under attack. Maybe it's just the situation that Alliance is LGD's kryptonite. We saw it at WCA.
Yeah.
They beat them in the finals and here again.
I think that there's the two factors where Alliance do very well against LGD, and also that this was not a match for LGD they had to win necessarily. It is for sure a slightly different draft in LGD than what we've been seeing.
Roche will go down here for Alliance, Loader to pick up the Aegis, and the top lane, Sylar, he's gonna just TP straight out of this one. I'm gonna be one to hang about as S4. Looking to start building, go for the BKB after the Orchid, I imagine, with that Mithril Hammer, feeling that that's going to be necessary this game. And I guess, in any game where we've got the DP, the Earth Spirit, a couple of silences, and of course a lot of magical burst damage when you look at that lineup. And
about
pretty much purely, apart from obviously Gyro once he gets farmed and the DP's ultimate.
You're looking good if you can just build BKBs on the Alliance side. You can kill the Death Prophet so fast this game too that I don't think you're too worried about Exorcism just yet. It's a very, very poor Prophet, and this is where we've just seen Death Prophets unable to come back from if you have this bad start.
And they still very much needing to look for some answers here, LGD. At the moment, it's just trying to get that farm onto Sylar's Jara. He's neck and neck with the Quap at least, but still 2k behind the enemy carry. Loader here, fucking up the money on top of the Yasha and the Battle Fury. I mean, this game, does he go for the Manta stun next? I guess with the silences that we talked about, Manta could be pretty strong.
Yeah, I think Manta's
finishing off. Or do you think he skips it and goes for something else? Just casual Yasha?
could do the casual Yasha, but I think ultimately, like at some stage, you'll want the Mantis style, just for the silences and Dyer's all that. Tower is under attack. Whether it's his next item pickup or he stops off to something like a Desolator could be good if they want to push and break high ground. He could himself could get a BKB as an alternative, but he's bought a recipe, I think that was
Manta probably, isn't it?
Manta recipe, and he'll pick it up. The illusions just help break the high ground, even if they get
the push.
They get pretty easily taken out by Gyrocopter and other. Nice little bit of, like a very secure, stable item to pick up.
They're on the mid lane. Alliance, they're going to be at the point where they're ready to break the high ground. They, of course, still have that Aegis here, and all the ultimates are up. Already seen S4 hit some big sonic waves. Looks like, I guess Alliance themselves, they don't feel too much pressure here to end it anytime soon. They know that Bulldog's getting the farm. He's working his way up. He's second on the net where, and, you know, with that Radiance of 20 minutes in, he's just going to continue to spiral out of control.
Because you're kind of like versing LGD, you know how good they are at defending high ground, and you're thinking, like, you're in Alliance's shoes, you know you've got this massive lead. Like, you're up by 10, 15k gold or whatever it may be. You don't know the exact numbers, but you can feel like all your cores are farmed, your support's in a great position, you're out leveling them. But you know the one way LGD gets back in is by going for a high ground push. And you look around, like, at Alliance, you're thinking, okay, what items have we got to break high ground? You're like, we haven't got AC yet. Queen's only got the BKB Orchid, which. BKB is good for pushing the Orchids, like that pick-off item, so I think you're ideally looking at another item or two for a few heroes. And I think the Ag Scepter on the Chen, the biggest one that for them, the Ags on the Chen as well as just having like level 16 ultimates, so having level 3 Sonic Wave, level 3 Omni Slash, well, those are the two big level 3 ultis for the team to go for that push. Well, the Chen Ag's still a bit of a ways away, unfortunately, for Alliance.
And they'll just go for this tier 2 here, and LGD, they're not going to want to do too much about it. They do throw out the stun, but in fact, it's S4 jumping straight in with the silence on TMMY telekinesis as well, bringing the Earth Spirit back. The root is there. The Earth Spirit is down, and that's going to be more than enough space for Alliance to quickly dispose of this tier 2. Meanwhile, Sylar looking for a bit of split push action on the top, working on a tier 2 of his own. Mid lane, maybe he's already ready with the TP back, knowing that there's a chance that Alliance might try and go high ground. The loader just storming in onto the tower. S4 on the sidelines. Does still have that Sonic Wave available. Do what LGD can do to stop this, S4. Down the Shadow Strike onto maybe. We'll take a Fortune's End there. Be careful, LGD. S4, we need to watch him. He's going to look for the perfect angle once this kicks off and see how many heroes he can hit with the Sonic Wave. Coming for in, there's your Exorcism. But maybe already, look at the damage from Loader. Maybe he's got to use himself. The Sonic Wave flies out to DDC with the Orchid as well. He's ticked down. Blade Fury chasing down the Death Prophet. Two to drop on LGD. There's a BKB outside, but it doesn't matter. The Omni Slash comes through for Loader. That's a third down. MMY in trouble as well. He's trying to do what he can with the combo. And GG's just called straight up. Alliance have done it, taking down LGD, a team that no one else in the group has been able to defeat. And this game, LGD just looking a bit all over the place, but as you said, maybe some reasons for that.
Yeah, I think the big thing for Alliance is they just did it with ease. They said, you guys are going to do something a bit different that year, like an uncomfortable draft. Yeah. We've got all our heroes, we've got the Lone Druid.
Yeah, we're just going to comfortable.
We're just going to stomp you.
That was pretty much all their comfort roles.
Yeah,
was
like, all you got Akki-Chen, I mean, maybe like EGM Rubick, not like a comfort hero per se.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, there's a few slightly...